I'm Faith Fitzpatrick. I work at the U.S. Geological Survey with a team of scientists studying the effects of urbanization on stream ecosystems. In this video, we'll look at how urban development alters the habitat or the physical features where creatures live in or near the streams. Habitat is made up of four basic things: water, shelter, food, and space. Flowing water is important to provide a diversity of habitats and food for all sorts of creatures. Healthy streams typically have a range of flows that change through the seasons. Healthy stream habitats have a diversity of water velocity and depth combinations and geomorphic features, such as shallow rapids and deep pools, and many bends and curves. Boulders and logs in the stream and grass and shrubs along its banks offer protection during floods and provide food and cover from predators. It's not just the stream that provides habitat for fish, but how the stream is connected to the land in low-lying areas along its banks. Low areas right next to the stream help alleviate flooding and also provide shelter, refuge, and food for amphibians, insects, reptiles, and birds. A natural area along a stream helps to connect the stream with the surrounding land.
In a healthy stream, the stream bottom can be made up of sand, gravel, pebbles, rocks, and boulders. A diversity of particle sizes is good for providing a range of habitats. For example, fish might use gravel for spawning, such as we have here. Whereas turtles might like something better like sand for laying their eggs.
It is important that a diversity of habitats are along a stream from upstream to downstream. This is especially important for streams that flow into lakes or oceans. For example, adult salmon may spend most of their life at sea, but need to move up into freshwater streams to spawn on gravel riffles. Young fish may live in headwater streams or small side channels where the flows are less swift, food is abundant, and there are places to hide. In urban watersheds, runoff from roads, parking lots, and rooftops, and the addition of storm sewers cause more frequent and erosive flows because less rainfall is soaked into the ground. For the same reason, between storms or rainy seasons, urban streams may dry up.
Many urban streams were previously in agricultural settings, and even before development were affected by runoff from fields.
Large amounts of sand, silt, and clay from bare soils at construction sites smother gravel riffles, clog channels, and fill in pools. Fine sediment can accumulate contaminants and nutrients and is a real problem in streams with gentle slopes or at the mouths of rivers where contaminants may accumulate and remain for centuries. Storm flow acts like a fire hose that scours stream beds and banks and destroys and unravels the physical features that aquatic creatures call home.
We're standing by Honey Creek in a more naturalized section of the river where it doesn't have the cement walls and bed to hold in the erosive force from the floods that come ripping through here after a big rainfall. And one of the things that we can see is the eroding banks. This is a common thing that happens in urban streams because of all of the erosive force from the flows. And then also there's a big area of gravel that's exposed on the channel bed, and that is there, kind of an over-widened channel, and there's not much flow there for the fish or the creatures to live in or for the fish to migrate.
Eroding channels and bigger floods can have major impacts on people by damaging roads, bridges, pipelines, and buildings and causing safety hazards. Channels are often enlarged and straightened and lined with rock or cement to contain floods. Houses built close to the streams leave no room for natural vegetation along the banks. These channels have no habitat to offer any creatures and are hazardous to people who may fall in and can't get out. As streams are lined with cement, go underground, or are altered by dams and road crossings, the connections among habitats are lost,
limiting the movement of fish and other organisms. Vegetation along an urban stream is frequently overrun by aggressive invasive plants. Most invasive plants start out in people's gardens, but they easily spread to banks, floodplains, and wetlands, where they crowd out native plants.
The area next to the river, next to the cement, is filled in with some pretty large trees over the years. A lot of these are invasive species of buckthorn, and then trapped in the buckthorn is flood debris, which gives us an idea of how fast and furious the water moves through these channels. So as you can tell, it's up over the top of my head.
As people connect with their streams, we expect beautiful stream corridors and livable, fishable, swimmable waters in urban areas. Watershed volunteer groups connect with regional planning commissions, sewerage districts, and city planners and engineers to improve the livability of urban stream corridors for both wildlife and humans. Through the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, the Milwaukee Metropolitan Sewerage District has been able to speed up its goal of removing or redesigning cement line channels that block fish passage. These rehabilitation projects are reconnecting habitats and also improving aesthetics and safety for people while maintaining flood control. Most of the Kinnikinnick River is cement lined from its headwaters to its mouth at Lake Michigan. The Milwaukee Metropolitan Sewerage District has started to replace the dangerously slippery cement channels with rock-lined channels. The design includes a smaller inset channel that keeps the water deep enough for fish to swim in during low flows. The rock-lined banks will be terraced to provide some additional flood storage and easier access for people. All the design features are armored with very large rocks to be able to withstand the high flows during floods. Sometimes nearby houses have to be removed in order to widen the floodplain area of the channel. Sometimes the old cement channels cannot be removed altogether, but rocks are added for fish cover and resting points as the fish migrate upstream to more natural reaches. In other places, floodplains can be expanded into existing parks, forest preserves, or vacant lots. It is difficult to find a river or stream where road crossings or dams don't act as longitudinal barriers for fish passage. Through public and private grants, many of the dams are being removed, such as the Simpkins Dam on the Patapsco River near Baltimore, Maryland.
We're standing on the banks of the Milwaukee River next to the Thiensville Dam. This is one of the few remaining dams on the Milwaukee River that's blocking fish passage from the upstream parts of the Milwaukee down to the mouth in the city of Milwaukee.
Sometimes it is impossible to remove a dam, and alternatives are used, like this constructed fish bypass channel around the historic Mequon-Thiensville Dam on the Milwaukee River in Wisconsin. Once completed, it will reconnect 158 miles of streams with Lake Michigan and the lower Milwaukee River. Bypass channels make it possible for fish to move upstream and downstream, including pike, walleye, and maybe even sturgeon. Connections make it possible. It takes county, state, municipalities, consultants, conservation groups, nonprofit agencies, and private companies, and volunteers working together to make big projects like this successful. Reconnecting streams doesn't stop with removing cement line channels and dams. An expansion of Interstate I-94 from the Illinois state line to Milwaukee was an opportunity to try some innovative culvert designs, daylight channels, and restore wetlands for headwater streams and storm drains in the Kinnikinnick and Root Rivers. When stream and wetland rehabilitation techniques are combined with stormwater management practices, floods are reduced, water quality is improved, and fish, wildlife, and humans benefit. In headwaters, spring-fed creeks contain critical spawning habitat for regionally important fish species, such as brook trout. Road expansion projects are some of the first signs of urban development, and it is crucial that construction designs contain plans for stream protection or habitat improvement. In agricultural headwaters of Milwaukee, The Green Seams program helps farmers to keep land from being developed in order to preserve infiltration and groundwater recharge. Keeping as much water as possible from running off the land helps to recharge spring-fed creeks, protect habitat, and reduce floods. Because of the importance of preserving salmon and other species on the endangered species list, habitat improvement and protection in the Portland, Oregon area is first and foremost in rehabilitation projects. Large logs are used in many of the rehabilitation projects to provide shelter and resting places for fish and other creatures. They also add complexity to physical structure and add roughness to floodplains to slow flood flows. The City of Portland just completed the construction phase of a new project at the confluence of Tryon Creek with the much larger Willamette River. Designing the project was tricky because water backs up into Tryon Creek when the Willamette River floods. However, this project added important off-channel habitat and channel complexity, specifically geared toward salmon species on the endangered species list. In addition, invasive species were removed from the stream corridor and replaced with native vegetation. The banks of Tryon Creek were laid back to add more floodplain storage. The project was successful because of good communications and connections between City of Portland staff and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. Near Annapolis, Maryland, the protection of Chesapeake Bay has brought together a diverse group of water resources planners and managers, as well as engineers, ecologists, and landscape architects. Together, they are pushing the envelope on innovative integration of stormwater management and stream and wetland rehabilitation. They've been using sand seepage systems, base flow channels, and plants to filter stormwater. These techniques reduce runoff, peak storm flows, bank erosion, and gullying while improving infiltration, water quality, and habitat. The sand seepage systems are being used in new developments and retrofitted to older developments. Because of the hilly topography, many communities have extensive channel erosion problems caused by too much stormwater runoff. The sand seepage berms and swales are used in new green residential developments in headwater settings, such as this new development in the headwaters of the Jabez Branch, a tributary to Severn Run, which has the last reproducing brook trout population on the coastal plain of Maryland. The seepage berms and swales act like large filtering systems along the roadside before the water flows into the channels and down the hill slopes and into Jabez Branch. The swales are planted with native plants and trees that are integrated into the landscaping designs. The diversity of habitats created in a wetland complex at an old mill pond setting along a highly urban section of Howard's Branch is just amazing, not to mention the water quality benefits. An important part of rehabilitation projects is measuring success. This can be done in many ways.
Another thing that's important for habitat a lot of times is the maximum pool depth, because that's where the fish will hang out during low flows. So here, you know, this isn't much of a pool, it's only about a foot deep.
Habitat measurements include such things as stream bed characteristics, the amount of in-stream cover, channel geometry and geomorphic features, the amount of siltation, water temperature, a range and depth of and velocity combinations, and riparian vegetation type and structure. It is also important to measure longitudinal and lateral connectedness in terms of distance to nearest barrier or height of the banks.
Is this stuff here? And then there's a bunch here. And there. So it's an old buried soil in here of some sort. But it's a sign that that we can use for age dating deposits. So we get an age on there, and then we can tell when the sediment was deposited over the top.
Traditionally, habitat assessments have focused on adult fish habitat. But over the last few years, they've expanded to be more inclusive of other species, such as amphibians, turtles, and insects. It is important that these measurements be quantitative enough to detect changes before and after projects and over time. Monitoring flow, water quality, habitat, and biological characteristics before, during, and after rehabilitation activities, they add extra expense, but these activities are especially critical for projects where there is a high risk to infrastructure or endangered species.
From this gauge house, we can take stage and flow and also collect water quality samples. And these can be done continuously over the course of an entire year and in the morning, night, and also on weekends. So it saves us from having a technician out here all the time.
Integral to all the rehabilitation projects we've discussed is the connections among citizen groups, planners, and engineers. Milwaukee is forging ahead through unique partnerships among governments, special purpose districts, nonprofit organizations, local residents, and businesses, such as the recent Menominee River Watershed Action Team planning meeting.
You know, we're really going to need, you know, the municipalities and others to help us with that work. And that's, you know, that's significant work.
Can I make a comment?
Yeah.
As a person that sat in on the budget hearings from MSD a few weeks ago, the thing that struck me about it is how few of the members of the public actually go to sessions like that and voice their opinion about projects that involve huge environmental impacts and huge amounts of dollars. And so the point that I'd make relative to the comment of what can private citizens do, if you think particular investments make sense for your community, to make sure that your local officials know that, or to stay informed and spread what you know to other citizens, it's actually hugely important. I was amazed that I think there were four people that morning. You know, this is hundreds of millions of dollars being discussed. You have more power than you think, because a lot of us don't make time to let our voices be heard.
For urban streams, hope for habitat is all about connections, reconnecting the continuum of habitats that streams provide from their headwaters to mouths, reconnecting streams to floodplains and wetlands, and most importantly, reconnecting people with each other and their streams.
As today, Hammond Middle School students picked up over 2 tons, which is 5,279.
These rehabilitation projects show how many different parts of habitat can be improved.
We've seen just a few examples of the many stream rehabilitation projects that have improved habitat both longitudinally and laterally, connecting floodplains, adding fish passage, and also providing more flood storage and improving water quality. I'm sure in the future we'll see many more projects such as these that also help to beautify the riparian areas along the stream and also improve the quality of urban communities.
Downstream aspect, 80. That's it for this reach.
Thanks for your interest in our study of the urbanization effects of stream ecosystems conducted as part of the National Water Quality Assessment Program of the U.S. Geological Survey. Please visit our website for more information about the study and also access to our data and our reports.